one special day, once every year, our chance to pray on Mother's Day for moms so dear, one chance to give our love so fair to all our mothers, we can give God's gifts to share. The written words we offer with flowers fully grown, the spoken words we offer express the thanks we've shown. Our love we have forever true. The ones who gave us all our lives with their love too. We give our thanks for all they gave. We are so thankful for our moms. We've much to save. And now we want to offer the things we need to share. The love and gifts we offer show how our hearts do care for all our mothers on Mother's Day.
Our first lesson comes from the book of Acts, the 9th chapter, verses 36 through 43. Now in Joppa there was a disciple whose name was Tabitha, which in Greek is Dorcas. She was devoted to good works and acts of charity. At that time she became ill and died. When they had washed her, they laid her in a room upstairs. Since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples, who heard that Peter was there, sent two men to him with the request, "Please come to us without delay." So Peter got up and went with them, and when he arrived, they took him to the room upstairs. All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other clothing that Dorcas had made while she was with them. Peter put all of them outside, and he knelt down and prayed. He turned to the body and said, "Tabitha, get up." Then she opened her eyes, and seeing Peter, she sat up. He gave her his hand and helped her up. Then calling the saints and widows, he showed her to be alive. This became known throughout Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. Meanwhile, he stayed in Joppa for some time with a certain Simon, a tanner. Here ends our first lesson. Our second lesson comes from the book of Revelation, the 7th chapter, verses 9 through 17. After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb." And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshipped God, singing, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these robed in white, and where have they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you are the one that knows." And he said to me, "These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple, and the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat, for the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Here ends our second lesson. Our gospel lesson is according to St. John, the 10th chapter, verses 22 through 30. At that time, the festival of the dedication took place in Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the portico of Solomon. So the Jews gathered round him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Messiah, tell us plainly." Jesus answered, "I have told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name testify to me. But you do not believe because you do not belong to my sheep. My sheep hear my voice. I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand. What my Father has given me is greater than all else, and no one can snatch it out of the Father's hand. The Father and I are one." The Gospel of our Lord. Thanks be to God.
Greetings, sisters and brothers in Christ. The title of our message for this fourth weekend of Easter is "Take My Hand and Raise Me Up." Let us pray. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So, sisters and brothers, throughout this 7-week season of Easter, we have been thinking about the resurrection of Jesus and how it changes your life and mine, how we are raised up with Christ to walk in newness of life. So today, or this weekend, is also Mother's Day. And for my children's sermon, I'm going to use this little statue someone had given me. And I'm going to talk to them about how God is like a loving mother and how there's a word in the Hebrew language that's used throughout the Hebrew Bible, and the word is hesed, and it means loving kindness, literally mercy, compassion, literally womb love. It speaks of God's womb love for us. And the reading, there are many readings in the Hebrew Bible which speak of this womb love, mother love for us. But on Mother's Day, I always think of Isaiah 49, verses 14 through 16, where the prophet Isaiah is speaking to the people and he says, "You say, God has forsaken me, God has forgotten me. Can a woman forget her nursing child or show no compassion, womb love, hesed, for the child of her womb?" And I remember being a nursing mom and reading that passage and thinking, oh my goodness, the answer to that question is absolutely not. When you're a nursing mom, your body will not let you forget your nursing child, because when it comes to be feeding time, your body aches, your breasts ache, they hurt, they're bursting to feed your child. And it's painful, it's literally painful. And I think of how that's kind of like us with God. God aches with this hesed, this womb love, this mother love to feed us, to nurture us. And until we say yes to that, that God has this aching longing to feed us. So Isaiah 49, 14 to 16, "Can a woman forget? Can a woman show no compassion for the child of her womb? Can a woman forget her nursing child? Even should these forget, I will never forget you, says our God. See, I have inscribed you on the palm of my hand. And when I preached on this years ago, someone gave me this sculpture. It's like the hand of God with us as the child in God's hand. My mother now lives in the heavenly kingdom. This November will be 14 years, but she's with me every day. And I always get a little sad around Mother's Day, especially when I go in the stores and I see all the Mother's Day things. I miss my mother. And also her birthday was May 12th, and sometimes would fall right on Mother's Day. So I'm always thinking of her every day, but especially at Mother's Day time and at the time of her birthday. And my most predominant memory of my mom, whenever I think of her, is of her hands. And my mom was always busy, very active woman, and she loved work. She loved cooking, she loved cleaning, she loved playing with her children and her grandchildren. She loved doing home projects. She was always busy, and she loved to work with her hands. And she had strong hands, and it's whenever I think of her, I think of her hands. And the most common way I think of her hands is like this, because my mother was also a woman of deep prayer. And so I always think of her hands clasped in prayer. Today in the Christian church, May 8th actually, Sunday in the Christian church, we celebrate the feast day of my favorite saint, Saint Juliana of Norwich. My third child is named Juliana, after Juliana of Norwich. And she's my favorite saint and mystic. And she wrote very much about Jesus as our mother. And so I also think of Juliana every Mother's Day. She writes about Jesus as our mother, and she says, in the Eucharist, Jesus our mother feeds us like a pregnant woman feeds her child within her womb with her own flesh and her own blood, with her own body, her own presence. And I think of that. Every time I take the Eucharist, I think of Jesus, our mother, feeding us with his own body, with his own blood, with his own presence in the Eucharist. So Juliana of Norwich also celebrates Jesus as mother, something we can remember on this Mother's Day. In today's gospel, Jesus is acting very motherly. I remember the time when Jesus is weeping for the city of Jerusalem, and he says, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how often have I longed to gather you to myself as a mother hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you would not. And today I hear a similar kind of motherly, protective tone in Jesus in today's gospel. We're told that he's walking through the temple in Jerusalem, and it is the time of the Feast of the Dedication in winter. And that is the dedication of the temple in the festival of Hanukkah, the festival of lights. And that celebrates the Jewish triumph over their enemies during the Maccabean revolt, when they took back the temple in Jerusalem from their enemies who had profaned it. And they cleansed the temple and they dismantled the altar and they put up a new altar. And they dedicated the new altar and the cleansed, purified temple to God. So Jesus is in Jerusalem for this festival. And he talks about himself as a shepherd whose sheep know his voice. And shepherds and mothers are both very nurturing, gathering their flock, their children, to themselves. And Jesus talks about, he says this thing about how we belong to him. We are his sheep, we hear his voice, we belong to him, and we are in his hands. Again, it's reminiscent of this statue. We are in Jesus's hands, and he says, and no one will be able to snatch us from his hands. I love that. And then he says also the Father has entrusted all that is his to Jesus, and Jesus entrusted all that he is to the fathers. And he said, we are one, and no one is able to snatch us from the Father's hands. So hands are very important in our readings today. And we use that saying a lot, oh, it's all in God's hands. But do we really think of what that means, that there's nothing and no one in this life that is able to snatch us from God's hands, from Christ's hands? And because of that, we secure, knowing we are in God's hands, knowing that God will never leave or forsake us, that God has us inscribed in the palm of God's hand, knowing that, we then are able to reach out our hands and help others and give others a helping hand, to take their hands and raise them up. And so I love the first reading for this day from the book of Acts. And the book of Acts is part two of the Gospel of Luke. Luke, but it comes out of the same community, same author. Luke takes us all the way through the death and resurrection of Jesus, and then ends with a brief telling of his ascension. And the book of Acts begins with Jesus' ascension, and then tells all the different acts of his apostles, of his followers, when he is no longer physically present. And so today we have a beautiful story about a woman named Tabitha in Aramaic, but that name in Greek is Dorcas. And in both Aramaic and Greek, it means gazelle. Tabitha or Dorcas. In Providence, we have the Dorcas Society, which Dorcas International House, named after this biblical Dorcas. And Dorcas is doing so much right now with immigrants and just does amazing work to help the people of God, especially those in need. And so in this reading from the book of Acts, Dorcas is a woman who was known for her good works and for her charity. She was always reaching out a hand and lending a helping hand to others. We're told that she was a seamstress, that she made clothing and she helped clothe others. And we're told in today's story that she had died. And she was from Joppa, which is on the coast, west, a little northwest of Jerusalem. And it's about 11 miles from Lydda. And Peter was in Lydda. So the Christians in Joppa sent a message to Peter saying, please come, because Dorcas, Tabitha, had died. And so Peter comes, and all the widows are gathered, weeping and mourning the loss of their friend, Tabitha. And Peter tells them all to go out, and he goes in the upper room where her dead body has been laid, and he prays. And then we're told that he says, "Tabitha, get up." And she sits up, and we're told that he reaches out her hand and he takes her by the hand and he raises her up. I love this story. In my class at Salve, I teach a class on women mystics and social justice activists. And my students always pick a particular woman mystic from long ago and then one from more modern times and write a paper on this woman of faith, this mystic, and how she has inspired their lives. And one of my students this past fall was very, very taken with Tabitha and wrote her entire paper, her project on Tabitha, and how this story about Tabitha raised this modern day young woman in my class, raised her up to new and transformed life. And that's what this season of Easter is all about, that we who have learned through the resurrection of Jesus, that we are in Jesus's hands, that we are in God's hands, that there's nothing and no one that can ever snatch us from God's hands. In the strength of that and knowing that to the depth of our being, we reach out our hands and clasp the hands of our sisters and brothers who are struggling and help to raise them up so that they too can walk in that newness of life, in that transformed and resurrected life. And, you know, Acts is part two, right, of the book of Luke. In Luke, and also in the Gospel of Mark, this story of Peter raising Tabitha is reminiscent of Jesus raising Jairus's, the synagogue leader's, daughter. And it's almost an identical story. And in Luke's version of it, right, it's, I'm sure as Luke wrote this story of Peter, he could remember the story of Jesus and Jairus's little daughter. And in Mark's version of Jesus raising Jairus' daughter, it says, he took her by the hand and said, "Little girl, get up, get up." So, sisters and brothers, in this season of Easter, how are we helping, reaching out a helping hand to others and helping to raise them up to new life? Our Lutheran church, usually every September, has asks us to celebrate a day when we speak about God's work, our hands. And I couldn't help but think of all the ways that hands were woven through today's readings. And on one of those Sundays here at First Lutheran, we celebrated God's work, our hands. I remember we had someone who's a mechanic and works with trucks, truck engines. And I remember him standing here. I'll never forget his sermon, his message. And he held up his hands, workman's hands, mechanic's hands. And he said, "God gave me the gift of my hands." And he said, "And I use the gifts God's given me to the glory of God, helping others and giving glory to God." So, sisters and brothers, another great mystic, Saint Teresa, said, "Today, Christ has no hands but your hands, no feet but your feet to go and share the good news, no eyes but your eyes to see the struggles of others, no mouth but your mouth to share the good news of new and resurrected life with others, no heart but your heart and my heart to love our sisters and brothers and to reach out that helping hand and raise them up, giving thanks to God who loves us with this mother love and who will never let anyone or anything in this life snatch us from God's hands. Amen.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on, let me stand. I am tired, I am weak, I am worn. Through the storm, through the night, lead me on to the light. Take my hand, precious Lord. Precious Lord, linger near when my life is almost gone. Hear my cry, hear my call, hold my hand lest I fall. Take my hand, precious
And now may God bless us and keep us. May God's face shine upon us and be gracious unto us. May God look upon us with blessing and grant us peace. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve God and the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen.